Right now, KD is on a generational high. A lot of people tend to forget that with GNOME being the face of Linux for such a long time, being the thing on the major distros people recommended, like your Ubuntu's, like your Fedora, that there was a time where things were different. There was a time where, well, GNOME and KDE didn't actually exist. Back in 1993, we had CDE, the Common Desktop Environment, and this actually is still getting releases now. Obviously at a much slower pace than it would have been back then, and there's not really that many people working on it, but somebody is working on it. When you know the name CDE, the name KDE starts to make quite a bit more sense. If you look at screenshots of CDE, and then early screenshots of KDE, like KDE1 during that cycle, you're gonna notice a lot of similarities. Now, KDE1 already was its own environment, but it took a lot of inspiration from it. And KDE1 first released in 1996. Following that wasn't actually GNOME, it was XSCE in 1997. This is around about when GNOME development first actually started, but 1.0 didn't release until 1999. Now, the birth date of GNOME is usually based off when development was started, so that's why next year is the 30th anniversary. Yeah, anyway. But back then, all of these environments were incredibly popular, and depending on the day of the week, depending on who you asked, XFCE might have actually been the most popular environment. And a big part of the reason for KDE's early fall is actually the license. Not the license of the environment, the license of the toolkit. Because back then, Qt was only available under a proprietary license. Back then, a lot of people were quite a bit more hostile to things that weren't free software, things that were maybe shareware, or even worse, just proprietary software. Technically, they're both proprietary software, but you know what I'm saying. A lot of people back then were using Linux because they supported free software. Now you have a lot of people that use Linux to get away from Windows. They don't necessarily hate proprietary software, they just don't like the way that Microsoft are doing things. And this is actually a big part of the reason why GNOME even exists in the first place. A lot of people didn't like the license of Qt and wanted another environment. Obviously, XFCE existed, but somebody wanted to make something new. Back then, GNOME was actually a part of the GNU project. It was actually named the GNU Network Object Model Environment. And when they split from GNU, they just started going by the name GNOME, but that was a very important part of the history. Even though this problem was dealt with in 1999, information traveled slowly back then, and a lot of people still think that Qt could be a problem for KDE and have no idea that that's long been solved. And with GNOME coming along and with it being from the GNU project, a lot of distros rightfully started shipping it because that's what you did with GNU software back then. And then things like Ubuntu came along, and whilst things like Red Hat Linux already did exist, Ubuntu really changed the game. Whilst a lot of people kind of have like negative opinions about Ubuntu today, it really did shake up the desktop Linux experience and really made it something that now the average person could reasonably use. Obviously, looking back on it now, it's very primitive, but for the time was a big deal. Things continued on, and then we saw the release of KDE 4 in 2008. And whilst KDE 4, towards the end of its life, actually fixed a lot of its problems, that first release was very rough. They changed a lot of things. They did way too much. In many ways, it was still considered a development release and probably should have been delayed at least a couple of months from there. But with KDE already trending downwards, that was just another nail in the coffin. That was just another reason why you shouldn't have been using KDE. And that did a lot of damage to the reputation. But through KDE 4, things continued to improve. Into Plasma 5, things actually started getting pretty good. Now in Plasma 6, well, now you're in a whole different world. No longer is KDE that like buggy secondary option that also happens to have a lot of things you can configure. Now it's actually a really good choice of an environment. And this isn't just me saying this, the numbers show this as well. I've shown this chart before, but this is Arch Linux package installation. That blue line you see that is towering above everything else, that's Plasma. Obviously, this is just one data point, but we can also look at the fundraiser, and this doesn't happen unless your environment is incredibly popular. This is way bigger than last year. It was bigger than the year before. It's probably going to be bigger next year because this is the direction that things are going for KDE. And this might not seem like a ton of money for like a big company, but KDE isn't a big company. KDE does have employees, and this guarantees that those employees are going to stay employees. Or if they want to, they can hire more employees, hire them for more hours, and the higher this number goes, the more it snowballs into more and more work being done. Also, in case you forget, the KDE fundraiser is not the entire year. Yes, they accept donations the entire year, but the fundraiser part is only the last 3 months of the year. There are donations that come in every other month as well. I don't know what the actual number is. We'll have to wait to see for the actual financial report, but it's a lot of money. And all of this work, all of this excitement, all of this amazing software culminates into something really, really cool. It may not be something that you necessarily are going to use because, well, buying a new car is probably pretty expensive, especially from Mercedes, but you do get really cool things like this. KDE goes vroom vroom. 2026 Mercedes-Benz CLA, the first car to run KDE's KWin, receives Car of the Year award. Now, the linked article we have here is in German, so I can't read this. And there doesn't appear to be an English button. Oh, wait, okay. No, the site's in English. So they have a thing to translate the site, but this article, I guess, doesn't have an English translation. But it's just like, you know, it's just them patting themselves on the back. We have a car, it won awards, that's great. But there is also a talk by Victoria Fisher of KDE back in 2023 about how Mercedes is actually using KDE software, wearing what might be the most ridiculous chain I have ever seen. Now, sadly, as is specified here, it is not yet official KDE merch. Maybe it'll happen. Hey guys, somebody make this happen. Where did you get this? How did you acquire this? And the talk produced one absolutely phenomenal image. This. Angry Birds into System Compositor. Cute into System Compositor. Netflix running in a 70-year-old car that's called a GP. What? Okay, let me explain what's actually being shown here. Sorry, before we do that, I just had to show you this frame as well. I'll just leave it on the screen for a few seconds. You know what? I respect the energy. Anyway, putting that to the side, what is being done here is traditionally when you're building an interface for a car, it was very tightly coupled together. The applications were tied to the UI was tied to the hardware, and if anything went down, the entire system died. And it's less likely the hardware's gonna have a problem, and more likely that one of the things that you wrote is gonna have some sort of issue, whether it be the application, whether it be the UI, and if something goes wrong, it all goes wrong. So instead of doing that, you do the sensible thing, which we've been doing on the desktop for a while now, which is you don't tie everything tightly together, you put a thing in the middle, so if the application dies, the application dies. If the UI dies, the UI dies. And the only thing that's gonna bring everything down is either the GPU or the system compositor. In this case, that being KWin. KWin has been very heavily developed, very heavily tested. It's not some just random little new thing that you just created on a weekend. It's been around for a long time and serves as that stable base to build your software on. As a reminder, car companies only became software companies maybe in the past 10, 15 years. So a lot of them are relearning lessons that everybody else in the software industry learned like 50 years ago. This whole situation was also talked about in the recent entry of This Week in Plasma. I don't know how you managed to find this exact timestamp, but I love this one as well. In case you didn't know, Nate isn't the only one doing this now. He now has a bunch of people to help him out, so hopefully things keep going well with This Week in Plasma. I don't know how active each of these people are going to be. I don't know if one of them is maybe going to take over things long term, but there are people helping out now, so that's cool. And just in case you were wondering, yes, Mercedes did become a sponsor of KDE. They are not just using KDE tech. Ambition. So Ambition is their spin-off brand, their software-focused brand that is building and implementing infotainment systems for future generations of Mercedes-Benz cars and utilizes KDE technology and know-how for its products. And this is the kind of thing that just wouldn't have happened without the years upon years of amazing work from KDE developers. Going from that point where people were kind of turning away because of the license of Qt, to then having the terrible release of KDE4, to then building things back up and actually regaining the respect of users, regaining that interest, and actually making an environment that people want to be using. On that note, have you ever looked at the list of sponsors for KDE? So down the bottom of their website, there is a list right here. Obviously of brands like Canonical, but Google is here. I don't know how long they've been here for. Apparently a while. But that's also really cool. SUSE, Qt, obviously Qt because, you know, Blue Systems, which is like the company. It was the old company that was doing consultancy work. Then that split off into Tech Paladin, Slimbook, Tuxedo. Obviously, these are like very Linux-focused brands. Kubuntu is KDE, so like you couldn't do anything without it. And then randomly, GNUPG.com. I've talked about it a bunch of times, but we're also seeing a lot of adoption in the gaming space. SteamOS, Valve's Linux operating system, uses KDE Plasma for its desktop mode. Now, yes, on a device like the Steam Deck, not everyone is going to be running it in desktop mode all the time. Most of the time, they're just going to be playing games on it. But if you've never used Linux before, and you decide you're going to go into desktop mode because, I don't know, you want to install some mods, you want to do some emulation, you want to do something else, you want to do something that is not on Steam, you're going to be presented with KDE Plasma. That's going to be your first look at Linux. Then we have things like the Steam Machine coming out, running the exact same thing, and the Steam Frame also running the exact same thing. For a lot of gamers, the first look they are going to get at Linux is KDE Plasma. And because of that, there's a lot of people who, when they want to switch to Linux, want a SteamOS-like experience on their desktop. Sometimes that means actually something like SteamOS, and you're talking about a project like Bazite, where it opens up into Steam Big Picture mode and you have KDE Plasma as an option. But for a lot of other people, they don't necessarily want the Steam Big Picture mode, they just want that KDE Plasma desktop that they saw on the Steam Deck. And Bazite is certainly one way to do that, but a lot of other people talk about things like CacheOS as well. And whilst this does package basically every desktop under the sun, in their installer, option number one right at the top is KDE Plasma. Then you have the fantastic work of the Fedora KDE team. And whilst this has existed as a spin for, I don't know how many years at this point, quite a long time, something really important happened recently. Maybe about a year ago. If we go back to the Fedora website, there is this button right here for latest release. Clicking this takes us down to this. Right next to workstation, KDE Plasma. It was promoted to be at the same level as workstation. Now you might say, oh, it doesn't matter if it's a spin or an addition, it's still the exact same software. And yes, that's true to an extent. But let's imagine you're a new Fedora user and you don't know what you want to download. You see this thing here, latest release, so maybe you scroll down a bit and you see all of these options here. Okay, you can go and download them directly. Or you can go to Get Fedora, and then we have the additions. And then you have the Atomic Desktops. And then you have the spins. And Fedora KDE, was in this list, and this is a massive list. Yes, it was near the top, but it was three lists down in a submenu. This greatly hurt the visibility of the environment, but now it's right here. Now it's right on the homepage, and I have no doubt this has massively increased the amount of people that are downloading it. And I will be doing a dedicated video on this one, or maybe it's already been released. I don't know. Budgie is also building off of KDE Frameworks now. No longer is this a GTK environment. It's KDE Frameworks, it's Kirigami, it's Qt 6, at least when Budgie 11 comes around. And none of these things individually change the direction of KDE, change the course of history. Each of these things is a little step in that direction. Each little bug fix, each feature addition that users really, really wanted and have been asking for a long time. Every little thing that is seen as a positive change builds up that positive perception around the environment, and over time, you get to where we are now. KDE hasn't been this popular in 20 or so years, and I don't see it slowing down. And KDE actually used to be an option in RHEL. Part of the reason why it's not anymore is because for a long time, KDE's had this really weird, inconsistent release model where different parts of the environment all release at different times, and it's kind of a mess. There is a reason why GNOME has the 6-month release model. One release, another release, point releases in the middle. It is very convenient for the distros, and that is something that KDE is certainly working towards, and once that happens, I don't know. Are we going to see a massive shift? Are we going to see KDE come back to a lot of environments? Are we going to see options where KDE is available being promoted? I would certainly love to see it. But what do you think? What do you think about this run of KDE? What do you think about this excitement around the environment? And what do you happen to be running right now? I'd love to know. So, if you liked the video, go like the video. Go subscribe as well. And if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribes, Daily Berapay, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and what an environment.